All right, it is 11 o'clock Eastern, my time. It is obviously different times all over the world, so good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whenever you are. Yes, we should have a link for closed captions. Let me try to find that real quick. Well, I will follow up with that in just a second and make sure it's available in the chat. But first, let me thank our sponsors, the Evergreen Community Development Initiative and Mobius. They are sponsoring our conference, and we appreciate their support. And I want to introduce Linda and Ava, who are joining us to talk about localization, which is certainly a lot more than translation. And thank you, Andrea, for the link. All right, I will now go quiet, but I will pop back in to help with questions. And I'm really looking forward to this, so I hope everyone else is as well.
So good morning, everyone. I will wait for Eva to start sharing our slides, which has just happened. So it is an honor for us to be here with you today and to present a topic which we have been involved in for more than a decade now. My name is Linda Jancová, and together with my colleague Eva Cerniňáková, we will be speaking about our experience with using Evergreen in a non-English speaking country. Next, please. First of all, a little technical note. In case you wish to download these slides or view them in their original Google Slides format so that you can instantly click on any of the URLs we mention, please visit tinyurl.com/evergreentranslation. Eva will also copy this URL into chat. Next, please. Before we proceed further, let us have a look at two terms which describe our today's topic, internationalization and localization. In written text, abbreviated expressions I18N and L10N are often used, with 18 and 10 representing the number of omitted letters between the first and the last character. Overall, we can say that in both cases, we speak about means of adapting computer software to different languages, regional peculiarities, and technical requirements of a target locale. Next, please. While internationalization is a process of designing a software application so that it can be adapted to various languages and regions, localization is a process of adapting internationalized software for a specific region or language. That is about the theoretical background which we consider useful for our today's talk. Also, because internationalization and localization are rather complex topics, we will be sharing our insights from our own experience. This means that this presentation can be considered a case study focusing on Evergreen in the Czech Republic. Next, please. It is not the first time we have been present at the Evergreen conference, however. Back in 2015, we contributed with our greetings, which introduced all the members of our Czech micro community. Last year, as the conference was held as an online rather than in-person event, we took part as participants. This year marks the first conference for which we have prepared a full presentation. Next, please. As not everyone may be familiar enough with our geographical location, we have included a map showing that our country, the Czech Republic, is situated in the Central European region. Next, please. Our country is also known as Czechia. It is rather small, having less than 11 million inhabitants and an area of less than 80,000 square kilometers. Next, please. We have a beautiful capital called Prague. Now you can enjoy the view of the Prague Castle, overlooking a number of other historical monuments. Actually, one of them, located across the river, is called Klementinum. It serves as the seat of the National Library of the Czech Republic, which happens to be the library I work for during the day. Next, please. And the last picture from Prague, which has been carefully selected to confuse you a little bit. You can see something which looks like the Eiffel Tower, but in fact, it is a lookout tower in Prague, which has been inspired by the Parisian landmark. Next, please. Enough of geography and history for now. If you take a closer look at the Czech library landscape, you may find out that we probably have the densest library network in the world. We have more than 5,000 libraries, which are on the Ministry of Culture's list. The huge number of libraries stems from the fact that in 1919, our first library law was passed, and this law made it compulsory for all municipalities to have a library. Next, please. Fast forward to the 21st century now. Quite a number of these libraries, although they have different founding bodies, collaborate on various nationwide projects, mostly seeking efficiencies or ways of improving services to their patrons. It is good to always consider joining such projects because libraries are stronger together. Next, please. There are a number of such national projects in our country. Out of these, we shall briefly touch upon four of them. These are obalkyknih.cz, Authority Files, Union Catalog of the Czech Republic, and knihovny.cz. Next, please. Let's get started with the first project, obalkyknih.cz. It is an edit content provider focused on materials available in Czech libraries. It started back in 2008 as a book jacket provider. Over the years, more types of edit content, such as tables of contents, summaries, or user ratings, have been included. Currently, it contains about 2.3 million book jackets and almost 600,000 tables of contents. It is a service which is very popular with Czech libraries. Next, please. When it comes to Evergreen, we actually implemented the service twice, for the first time in 2012 and for the second time in 2016. Obviously, both Evergreen and the edit content provider change over time, and so it is rather likely that no solution can be considered permanent. After having created the current module, we managed to add it to master in early 2017. Next, please. This screenshot can serve as an evidence that we have indeed done so. It shows that our developer has committed the module. Next, please. When the module is switched on, the book jackets can be seen in the usual Evergreen way, showing both in the search results display and on the web pages with individual records. The image shows such a sample record. Next, please. If other edit content data are available and switched on, patrons can access them in the lower part of the record web page. Next, please. The second national project I have mentioned is a project dealing with authority records. In the Czech Republic, about 70 libraries collaborate on the creation of these records. This collaboration started about 20 years ago, and the key technology used for sharing the data is still the same old Z3950 protocol. The resulting authority records are provided by the National Library. Next, please. What is significant is the fact that Czech libraries are used to cleaning their bibliographic and authority data themselves, with no external companies involved. The usual procedure of adding new authority records to a library catalog consists of downloading the record in question from the National Library via the Z3950 protocol. However, Evergreen currently saves all authority records downloaded via this protocol as bibliographic records. Next, please. And one more note. Although we are a small country, the number of authority records is rather high. Currently, about 1 million records are in the file. In comparison, the Library of Congress provides about 11 million authority records. Therefore, using the whole authority file can be rather difficult due to its enormous size. It goes without saying that in practice, most libraries use just a fraction of the total number. Next, please. Back in 2017, we carried out a project to help Evergreen libraries use the Czech authority records. Given the authority file size and the need to add the authority records directly to the database, we came up with the following workaround. We selected only the authority records which had their identifiers present in the bibliographic records and applied string matching algorithms to cover cases when no authority identifiers were included in the records. Next, please. We have also prepared documentation. It is available via our documentation portal called Evergreen DocuWiki CZ. Next, please. The Union Catalogue of the Czech Republic is another important project in our library landscape. Since 1995, it has been made available in the electronic format. Now more than 500 libraries cooperate, meaning that they contribute with their data. The catalog contains about 8 million bibliographic records. The preferred way of contributing is via the Open Archives Initiative Protocol for Metadata Harvesting, OAIPMH, sending them to the server via the FTP, File Transfer Protocol, is also an option. Next, please. In 2018, we carried out a project aiming at letting Czech Evergreen libraries contribute to the Union Catalog via the OAIPMH protocol. To that end, we used code provided by the International Institute of Social History, which is based in the Netherlands. This code is not in Evergreen Master yet. It offers plenty of useful features, but unfortunately, not the option to organize the data into sets. Therefore, instead of using sets, we opted for adding a value in a MARC 21 bibliographic record field to indicate that the record should be sent to the Union Catalog. Then, via an XSLT template, XSLT stands for Extensible Style Sheet Language Transformations, we filtered the data so that we sent only the bibliographic records correctly marked for inclusion. Next, please. For those who may not be familiar with how the OAIPMH delivery works, we have included an example. Basically, it is very similar to Evergreen's SuperCat feature. Next, please. Of course, there are some costs involved in localization in terms of integrating Evergreen libraries to the Czech library landscape. So now it is a great opportunity to say a loud thank you to the Ministry of Culture of the Czech Republic. It has kindly provided financial support for the aforementioned projects via its grant scheme for libraries. The projects have been prepared, submitted and coordinated by Jabok Library and by Jan Langoš Library. Next, please. As to our plans for the future, we would like to start collaboration with the portal called knihovny.cz. It provides unified access to Czech libraries and their holdings. Next, please. Now let us have a look at some of the other localization issues. We have organized them into 8 categories, which are statistical reports, templates for printing and cataloging, accession numbers, Czech currency, cataloging interface, UTF-8 encoding, sorting, and deployment. Next, please. We will start with statistical reports. Czech libraries are required to provide statistical data about their activities to authorities. Czech authorities require, first, data which can be easily extracted from Evergreen, and second, data which are rather difficult to put together. One example of the latter can be patron account registration date needed in order to report how many users have registered or renewed their registration. Using customized reports can be a solution or a partial solution. Next, please. In order to avoid really complex reports or SQL queries, we use more customized reports to put the required set of data together. The screenshots show 2 Evergreen reports providing information on in-house use and on circulations and renewals, all designed to gather data for the official statistical form, which you can see on the left. Next, please. Local customization is also necessary in templates for printing. so the screenshots show templates localized into Czech. Next, please. When we speak about templates, these are not used just for printing, but also for cataloging. In this case, we can mention, for example, predefined language codes for Czech monographs, because more correct predefined values save the time of the cataloger. Next, please. Now, let us move on to accession numbers. Assigning accession numbers is mandatory for Czech libraries. Nowadays, some libraries actually incorporate accession numbers into barcodes, as can be seen on the left image. Some do not, and for example, call numbers under the barcodes. Of course, I mean the barcodes in the physical format now. Next, please. Also, not every material should be assigned an accession number. For example, individual serial issues should not have an accession number, but once the issues are bound together, the resulting volume should receive one. Next, please. Another difference between our country and the US is currency. We do not use dollars, although the word dollar is said to be of Czech origin, but we use Czech crowns. These are abbreviated as CZK internationally and as KČ in the Czech environment. There is not just a difference when it comes to names, but also when it comes to value. One US dollar can currently be exchanged to about 20 Czech crowns, and also the place in expressions. While US dollar is typically used before the amount, we use the KČ abbreviation after the amount. Next, please. In the billing interface in Evergreen, there are some places where the Czech crowns can be easily hard-coded. USD is replaced with KČ and also put in the correct place after the amount. Some places, though, are more difficult to customize. It is, for example, the table shown in the screenshot in the lower part of the slide, where you can still see the US dollars. It goes without saying that these interface inconsistencies can be confusing to library staff. Next, please. Now let us move on to cataloging interface, another challenge for some library staff. While in the US, probably more libraries focus on copy cataloging, Czech libraries often have to do original cataloging when the particular bibliographic record is not available for download. Evergreen cataloging interface makes heavy use of Mark 21 tags, such as 100, while Czech library staff would appreciate strings, in this case, main entry, personal name. They would, of course, expect the strings to be in Czech. Next, please. Context-sensitive help also tends to show up untranslated, as can be seen in the screenshot from the cataloging interface. Next, please. Czech language also uses diacritical marks. Evergreen does a pretty good job in using UTF encoding, but there are places where localization tends to be rather difficult. We have learned that library org units short names are much safer in ASCII-only characters, for example. Also, to make sure that our special letters do not get corrupted along the way, we use HTML entities to correctly display characters from our local edit content provider. Currently, we do not use search terms highlighting feature in search results because letters with diacritical marks do not get properly highlighted. It would then be rather confusing for patrons who would see some of their search terms highlighted and some not. Also, when the Evergreen library serves as a Z3950 target, it may be difficult to properly search using queries with diacritics. Next, please. Another area where localization can play a role is sorting. Although our alphabet is Latin and looks about the same as the English one, it is not quite the same. Getting back to the KČ example, the letter Č is supposed to be next in alphabet after C. It is not supposed to be treated equally to C. There are examples from catalog search results and from browsing showing that the correct order according to the Czech alphabet is not observed. Another case when alphabetical order is not correct is the reports interface, when all strings beginning with diacritical marks are at the very end of the whole list, which is not where they are supposed to be using the Czech alphabet. Next, please. We have mentioned a number of areas where some tweaks to better localize Evergreen are needed. These can be difficult to maintain across multiple instances of Evergreen. In 2015, it became easier, though, as we started our move from single plantings to consortia. In that year, the first Czech Evergreen consortium was formed, integrating Jabok Library with the Catholic Youth Hostel Library. Next, please. This consortium is called Common Catalog, also abbreviated as SPOC. Now it has 8 member libraries. Next, please. This screenshot shows how the homepage of the Common Catalog or SPOC looks like. Next, please. There is also another consortium which brings together Jan Langoš Library, which is part of the Institute for the Study of Totalitarian Regimes, and Security Services Archive Library. Next, please. This is the homepage of Jan Langoš Library Catalog, which, compared with SPOC, uses different graphics. Next, please. Personal library is a different type of consortium. While the previous examples were of libraries, the personal library is actually a consortium of librarians. It serves as a common installation for individuals who wish to catalog their home libraries. Next, please. This is how the personal library catalog's homepage looks like. Next, please. To sum up, there are differences in how libraries handle certain tasks depending on local conditions and also the way how particular software tools work. It is clear, though, that software from abroad can serve as a source of inspiration. It is true that sometimes things can indeed be done differently.
Linda, we have a quick question from Jane.
Yes.
About the OAI PMH sets. Would the Union Catalog only harvest certain sets of records?
Yes. It is exactly like that because there are some documents or some bibliographic records which should not be sent to the Union Catalog. Also, in libraries, there can be records which are not finalized yet, etc. So libraries need to mark somehow which records should be sent to the catalog and which not. So,
okay.
I would like to add a note just to sets because we would prefer having also sets for individual organizational units because the records are harvested together from all libraries from the consortium, and it's complicated for the staff in National Library who take care for harvesting.
Okay.
And the OAI PMH protocol can be used, and the sets can be used to take part in other projects. For example, that project called knihovny.cz, which we would like to participate in the future. So then you have to have a different URL for harvesting, which makes it a bit more difficult than it would be if the sets feature was present in the module.
And another quick question from Sharon Douglas: what brought on the desire for the personal library project?
Once more, please.
What was the reason for the personal library project? How did that start?
Yeah. We decided to start a project because we thought that if librarians had a chance to see Evergreen in action and try to use it as individuals, then maybe it would persuade them to switch to Evergreen from their proprietary ILS that they are using. So we thought that it would be a nice way to get acquainted with Evergreen and to really see what it can do, and that it is a very good software which can be used in multiple types of libraries, and which can serve as a system or software for the whole consortia.
Thank you. We have a few other questions, but I think they make sense at the end, so we'll let you get back to your slides.
Okay. So now we have covered. Eva, will you please move to another slide? Now we have covered the most important topics which we have had to deal with to make Evergreen fit well in the Czech library environment. And so far we have only briefly mentioned translations. This is what Eva will talk about in more detail, and I will just introduce the topic a little bit. It was back in 2008 when we started to translate Evergreen during an elective course at the Institute of Information Studies and Librarianship at Charles University in Prague. We used Moodle at that time and disseminated the files for translation via this e-learning platform. The results of our early efforts were shared with a wider audience at a library conference in early 2009. Next, please. Back in 2009, we also encountered first issues with implementing translations, as can be seen in this 12-year-old message sent to the OpenILS General Listserv. Next, please. Fast forward to 2021 now. This Launchpad translation overview clearly shows that a vast majority of Evergreen is translated into Czech, especially thanks to Eva, who is also the global coordinator of Evergreen translations. Next, please. When we speak about Launchpad, I would also like to mention that currently, in order to find bugs related to internationalization and localization, it is most useful to search for I18N tags. So this is from me now, and now I am handing over to Eva, who will provide more details on the translations. Good translation, after all, is what sells the product. So over to you, Eva.
So localization is much more than just translation. However, for users, it's really essential to be able to use the catalog function in their native language. And I personally also believe that the catalog interface available in various languages makes libraries more inclusive and more accessible to everyone. So in this part of the presentation, I will try to very, very briefly introduce how the Evergreen translation work, what translation looks like, what tools are used, and what issues translators need to address. Usually, we meet Evergreen catalog through its interface. Here you can see an example of small piece of the Evergreen interface, specifically the Hold Action drop-down menu in the Patron account with several actions like Suspend, Activate, etc. And also with the context-sensitive help that appears when you hover the mouse over the drop-down menu. Even if it doesn't look like that, there is the same interface in this slide. However, in this case, it's a tiny portion of the source code. You can see here several strings from the drop-down menu, like action for selected holds, suspend, etc. And as you can see too, the text strings in the source code are just in English. But of course, we need those strings to be translated into Czech, into Spanish, French, and other languages. So that's why it's necessary to mark those strings for translation in the source code, which is usually done by the code developer. So in this slide, you see again the same source code, but in this case, the strings have been already marked for translations. As you can see, each string is enclosed in a sequence of characters like person signed, brackets, apostrophe and so on that tell the Evergreen Catalog interface, hey, there is a piece of code that is translatable and that should be displayed as translated into the selected language. When a new Evergreen release is being prepared, strings marked for translations are extracted from the source code into these so-called POT files. POT stands for Portable Object Template. Each string in the POT file represents a message ID. And to each message ID should be assigned a message string, which is actually a translation. Message IDs and message strings are indicated by a prefix MSGID and MSGSTR. And as you can see, the message strings are still empty. This is all right because POT files are actually the basis for translations. The translations are usually not typed directly into the POT files. Usually an online tool or an application is used for translations. And for Evergreen translations, we use online tools Launchpad and PO Editor. So when the strings are extracted from the source code to POT files, the POT files are uploaded to Launchpad and PO Editor, and they are ready to be translated there by translators to individual languages. Then, when the new release of Evergreen is approaching, files with translated strings are downloaded from Launchpad and PO Editor and added to Evergreen source code as so-called PO files, which means portable object files. The PO files contain both the original string and their translation, or more precisely, message IDs and message strings. Let's have a short look at Launchpad now. In Launchpad, the Evergreen project translations are available when you click on the translation on the top menu bar. If you want to actively translate and not only see the translations, it is necessary to have user account in Launchpad and to be logged in. Now you can see the Evergreen project translation site in Launchpad with some basic information about Evergreen translation and the list of translation for master, the list of various languages. The language name link opens a list of individual translation templates for the particular language. The name of the template then again works as a link opening the interface for translation. And very useful is also the number of untranslated strings that works as a link opening the interface for translation, but with only untranslated strings displayed. This is what the translation interface itself looks like. When the translation on the page are completed, translations are saved by clicking the Save and Continue button. There are several useful functions in Launchpad or tools. I will mention, for example, suggestions generated from translations used for the same word or phrase in Evergreen or even in other software project available in Launchpad. Quite handy is the possibility to copy the entire phrase into translation box using little wheel with the blue arrow next to the English string. There are, of course, many other tools, including searching in all translated or untranslated strings, etc. The other tool, PO Editor, is used especially for translation of Angular strings. Evergreen project in PO Editor is available at poeditor.com/projects. And if you want to translate Evergreen, you need to have an account in PO Editor, and also your account must be approved by Evergreen admin. It is possible to ask for approval on the Evergreen general mailing list. There are also several useful tools available in Pio Editor, for example, to search or to display all strings, or only untranslated strings or translated strings. In the Pio Editor, there is a possibility to select strings by tags that are added to Pio Editor by Evergreen developers. I find it really useful. For example, it is possible to display only strings for the particular Evergreen release. In Pio Editor, translations are saved automatically, so it's not necessary to care for saving them. When translation in Launchpad or Pio Editor, when translating in Launchpad or Pio Editor, it's good to know that in some cases the part of string in Launchpad or Pio Editor should not be translated. It concerns, for example, data placeholders and variable names, formatting tags like XML, HTML, and so on. These untranslated parts often contain specific characters. So when you notice characters like person sign, various types of bracket, slash signs, etc., you could be on alert. If you are not sure what to translate, you can ask question on Evergreen mailing list. Here you can see some examples from Launchpad. There's HTML tag and variables that shouldn't be translated, marked yellow. And here you can see examples of Angular strings in Pio Editor. The yellow parts are Angular tags, which are not intended for translations. In order to translate Evergreen, you need, however, more than just translation tools. There are many challenges to be faced when translating. It is difficult to make a correct translation without knowing the appropriate context, because there are many synonyms, multiple searching, multiple meaning. Also, some strings in Evergreen only appear after a specific action is taken, and so on. For appropriate translation, it's essential to understand the background of the string. This means to know Evergreen software and its processes, the library terminology, ways how libraries work in context of local conditions, and much, much more. There are many ways how to determine context of the particular strings. Very useful is Evergreen software itself. For testing, you can use your own installation of Evergreen or Evergreen demo servers. Very useful could be the information in Launchpad or Pio Editor in which part of software the string is located. In the example from Launchpad on the slide, you can see below the translation box that the string's check is located in the files with the name containing bill or bill and payment. So it's clear that the meaning of the string has something to do with bills and payments and not, for example, with monitoring something. You can also find useful information in comments or context information. Here in the example from Launchpad, you can see that the variable used in the string, in this case, sign person sign and one, represents an organizational unit name. Some more information about the context of particular string can be found also in Evergreen source code. To find the string, it's possible to search Git repository using, for example, grep search or browsing. However, the browsing requires at least some basic knowledge of the file structure in Evergreen. It is also possible to search downloaded source code files using full text search in desktop tools like Total Commander or Midnight Commander in Linux. I would like to show you a few examples that illustrate quite well how the context is important, and on the contrary, how lack of context can result in completely misleading translation. Most of translations are created by students who translated Evergreen at the beginning, just because they didn't have the necessary knowledge of the context. For example, the term copy, which is used in Evergreen mostly for item, was translated in the meaning of reproduce. The phrase copy location order, used in Evergreen for sorting or of shelving locations, was translated in the meaning make a copy of location voucher. Or place hold was translated as place the handle, and so on. So you can see that such translations are much worse than an untranslated phrase. So please do not translate any strings if you are not absolutely sure what is it about. Very important is also terminology. Terms used in librarianship for the same string, for the same thing, in other languages may be based on a completely different concept. So it's important not to translate literally, but to use terminology common to the language in the given country. In Czechia, we have a database of library terminology, which is a very useful tool for translation. If you have similar tool, I strongly recommend to use it. It's also important to note that Evergreen, as any library software, uses many standardized terms. A lot of them are related to MARC format. For example, field and subfield names or terms used in numerous value list for codes and controlled vocabulary, like relators, gender terms, frequency issues, etc. In Evergreen, we use also terms from SQL, protocol and format names, names of countries, languages, etc. For translation of such terms, the standardized form should always be used. It is also important that the translation is not much longer than the original strings, because long string could cause issues in Evergreen interface, which actually applies not only to translations. I recommend always to use as short expression as possible. Displaying the short string in the interface is always easier than displaying the long one. However, sometimes the translation is simply longer and there's nothing you can do about it. In such case, it's necessary to be creative. In this slide, you can see an example of search result sorting in OPAC, where the Czech translation didn't fit into the form field and was too long. We solved at least part of the problem by rearranging the words in phrases and omitting the repeating word sort. In some cases, however, the creativity is prohibited, usually when it's necessary to use a standardized term. And as you can see in a few examples of standardized terms from the MARC code list of relators, the length of translation can sometimes be almost 3 times longer than original string. Also, abbreviation may be used differently in various languages. For instance, in Czech, some expressions do not have standard abbreviation, such as date of birth, abbreviated as DOB in English, or abbreviation for fixed fields used in MARC grid in Evergreen cataloging interface. I mean abbreviation for literary form, bibliographic level, data status, and so on. The problem is that if there is no abbreviation available, the translated string is usually much, much longer. Not only length, but also the order of the word in various languages may differ. For example, in the phrase no item with barcode, it is important that the word barcode is placed at the end of this sentence because it is followed by the barcode of specific item. But in Czech, placing the translation of the word barcode at the end of sentence is not ideal. In such case, we must then opt for a less ideal translation or a paraphrase. If I should summarize the basic recommendation for translators, they would be something like this. Translation must be understandable. It's necessary to adapt them to the language and the local context. It's necessary to be consistent in used expression. Using different terms for the same thing is confusing for both patrons and staff. It's necessary to understand what is translated. it's necessary to leave string untranslated until absolutely sure about the meaning of the string. Misleading translation is much worse than no translation. And it's good to read translation again. Typing error can happen to anyone. And it's really important to be as brief as possible. And translated strings should be as short as possible, of course. You can find more details about translation workflow and some more recommendation in Evergreen DocuWiki. I'm going to the end. However, I will mention one more topic. Sometimes you need to translate customized strings specific for your library or consortium. If these strings are not available in Evergreen software in general. Here you can see an example of customized template. Particularly, it's customized homepage of Yabok library catalog, containing many lists and links to searches for Yabok students. And you can see that the page is available both in Czech and in English. If the string is supposed to be translated, it must be marked for translation in the source code file, just like any other translation string in the source code. In this case, we see the OPAC template homesearch.tt2. You can see that customized names of lists have been marked for translation. Then it is still necessary to add the translation to a PO file in Evergreen that contains the translated strings in your desired language. In our consortium, in our common catalog, I usually add the translation to the PO file manually. And it's a good practice to comment the edit translation. For example, in which library, in which template, and in which part of the template, etc., is the string being used. I think it would be possible to talk about translation for a few more hours, but I will finish at this point as we do not have so much time. If you want to see what the translations of Evergreen into Czech looks like, you can use the Czech demo installation of Evergreen. Link is also available on Evergreen DocuWiki. Thank you very much.
We only have 2 minutes to go before the end of the session, and we had a few questions from chat. So I'm going to ask these, but hopefully we can move along pretty quickly. One is from Andrea. In regards to the currency designators not showing correctly for localization, do you know if that's consistent in all the grids?
I'm not really sure, but Eva will probably know.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch the first part of the question.
Can you change the inability to change the currency designator to a local one? Is that broken across all the grids or only a problem in some of them?
No, I think it's a problem in all the grids. We tried to set currency mm-hmm. in angular, but there was a problem that it showed CZK, so which is not desirable for us. So we decided to do it like this. But I think the grid without CZK, even when trying to set it in Angular.
Okay. And hopefully that is an underlying Angular thing that can be fixed in a single place. Another question was from Diane earlier. She asked, how many Evergreen consortia are there in the Czech Republic?
The three consortia I have mentioned in my part of the presentation, the biggest one is the Common Catalog or SPOC, which has 8 libraries involved or participating. Then there is a smaller consortium of 2 libraries, which is Jan Langosch Library and the Security Services Archive Library. And then we have the Personal Library Consortium of Librarians, where we have a couple of librarians taking part.
I would add that there is not very common, there is not common in the Czech Republic having consortia of independent library of different types. So it's a revolution having such consortia in Czech Republic.
Okay. And we had one last question, and this is potentially too big a question to answer right now. But Diane asked, what is it about Evergreen that made it a better option to translate it than use something that is already available in Czech? Were there any other options already in Czech that you felt were viable, or were you going to have to do translating no matter what?
Well, I think I can answer that question. Actually, we started being involved in Evergreen and in the translation efforts more than a decade ago when there were no other open source ILSs available in the Czech Republic. And so we decided to try and change the situation. And actually, we generated some interest, as can be seen by, you know, if you have a look at the number of libraries that use Evergreen, it's not exactly hundreds of or thousands, but some of them have been courageous enough to go for open source. And I think that it has persuaded some other libraries not exactly to switch to open source integrated library systems, but to be more interested in other open source or free software tools. And now I think that far more libraries use open source tools in their daily work than they did a decade or so ago.
Well, thank you for that. I have to head over to another session in a moment. People are welcome to continue talking in chat. I want to thank you for the presentation and for your involvement in the community. The presentation was great, and you certainly made Evergreen a better product and stronger community through your participation. So thank you.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you, Rogan.